My efforts at seeding the audience worked well. Thank you very much for being here today. Welcome to another RSA conference. It's awfully exciting. What I want to talk about is one of the biggest challenges that I think faces the IT industry and, in a sense, all aspects of industry now that we're all consuming and depending on IT, and that is the talent shortage in security. In particular, that means we don't have enough people to fill our dedicated security roles, and we're not doing the right things to educate people in non-dedicated roles around security. I'm thinking of developers in particular. When I got started in security over a decade ago, companies that had a IT security or software security function were typically in a couple of very narrow industries. They were primarily financial services, and the big ones at that, and they were people associated with the government and military for the most part. Today, security is distinctly everyone's problem. You can't look at the news without seeing a breach over the last few years in retail, in healthcare, in any number of different industries that now depend on computers and therefore have IT security challenges. So all of those companies are trying to hire new talent, and at the same time, we're competing against the US government and other governments who are also trying to hire a lot of talent. The DoD alone is scheduled to hire over 6,000 cyber warriors just in the next couple of years. And that doesn't account for all of the security professionals that are needed throughout the rest of the government, civilian agencies, and other places. HP and the Ponemon Institute did research last year to try to quantify this talent shortage. And what that research showed is that roughly 40% of security roles were vacant throughout 2014. And more concerningly, I think, when you look at senior roles, individual contributors and managers, that was almost half. It was 49%. And so we're in this constant battle, day in and day out, against adversaries that are more numerous, more capable, and frankly, more motivated by the financial gains that they are receiving today. And we're going into that battle roughly half staffed. You can't talk about computer science and what it means to be a computer scientist without looking at undergraduate computer science programs. Most programmers today have an undergraduate degree in computer science, and that's the extent of their training before they got into the workforce. We looked at the top 10 undergraduate programs, according to US News and World Reports, and we tried to answer two fundamental questions. First, could we expect that a graduate of one of these programs in 2014 will have taken a course focused on security, a course that gives them the fundamentals of security that they need to apply, just like they would take a course on the fundamentals of operating systems or data structures? The answer is, at these top 10 universities, none of them had a required course focused on security. The second question we tried to answer was, what are they doing around secure coding and secure development? Are they teaching programmers not necessarily what they need to know to do a security job, but what they need to do to know just to be a programmer? And what we found is, again, only 3 out of the 10 offered topics on software security. These weren't dedicated courses. These were just a handful of lectures on it, meaning 7 of the 10 didn't touch on that at all. We're going to talk a lot about academia today, but I don't want to come across as if I'm picking on them. There are major stakeholders in this problem from both government and industry, and stakeholders from all three of these communities, academia included, have both something to contribute to solving the problem, but also something significant to gain from solving the problem. And so as we talk about the 7 actions, the 7 steps that I advocate we all go forth and take to try to move the needle on this problem, I think we should look at involving stakeholders from as many of these three communities each time we embark on that challenge as possible. The first thing we need to do to fix the talent shortage in security is to fix computer science curricula. That's a hard problem. That involves really fixing 3 major areas, I think. First, it means fixing the textbooks, the artifacts, the quizzes, the lab materials, everything we use to mint our new computer scientists needs to be fixed because most of it was written without security in mind. Second, we need to retrofit our professors and lecturers. We need to bring knowledge that wasn't available when they learned computer science into the department. And that doesn't just mean hiring new faculty to teach security classes. It means investing in retraining people who teach other topics, operating systems, networks, data structures, around how to do those things securely. And then finally, the third leg of the stool is around verification. We absolutely have to enable professors and teaching staff to grade submissions in every course, I'm thinking especially a big project code, for security. Because in the real world, if they write insecure code, it's not going to be acceptable. And allowing them to do that in a university setting is just setting the wrong expectations. So this is a hard one. This is going to take a long time, but it can absolutely benefit from active engagement from the community. And so I think it's important for everyone to think about this big lift. I promise some of the next ones will be more tactical. This is a quote that my friend Joe Jarzembeck, who runs software security assurance at DHS, is really fond of, pressing the demand button. In the private sector in particular, he stresses that every company needs to highlight security, needs to make it clear that security is a priority for them in their communications and in the way they do business. That can mean things like making sure that security appears in every job description. When you're hiring a programmer or a tester or an IT ops engineer, make sure that the right security skill set is part of that description of what you're looking for. Make sure that security appears in your external communications, when you talk to customers, when you talk to partners, when you talk about the investments you're making in technology. Talk about what you're doing in security and talk about it in a positive way, not in an apologetic way. When you're engaging in new business relationships, whether it be outsourcing contracts or perhaps M&A activities, make sure that, again, security is part of the priorities that are being discussed in that context, because it's going to tell the rest of the company that security matters. And then finally, one of the challenges, of course, is attracting and retaining talent. And so consider running a security-centric internship program where you bring college juniors and seniors in, train them around the security knowledge that you need them to have while they're cheaper, and then hire them as full-time employees once they're out of school. It's not just about highlighting security externally, though. You really have to focus and highlight security internally. I want to share two examples of organizations that I think have done a really spectacular job of this. The first is from a large financial services firm on the East Coast. And they were an early customer of Fortify software, where I was a researcher. And as soon as they got Fortify deployed for static code review, soon thereafter, they started tying developer bonuses to metrics driven out of that software security assurance program. So programmers who avoided making mistakes, that was good, but more importantly, programmers who learned from those mistakes and corrected mistakes quickly were financially rewarded. And that set the priority for the entire development organization around security, or set security as a priority for the entire development organization. It was really powerful in terms of culture change. The other example I want to share is from my friend Brad Arkin at Adobe. And he has set up a training and certification program that has two attributes that I think make it really spectacular and work really well. The first is he has designed a kind of gamification of security training around a series of colored belts, like you might find in martial arts. And once you've demonstrated a certain kind of security knowledge or received a certain kind of security training, you are recognized with the award of a colored belt. Now, that's nice, and engineers like gamification, so this has, I think, increased the adoption of optional security training across the board, which is good. But the icing on the cake, the thing that makes it really spectacular, is that they have a program management and governance structure in place that ties the gamified security training back to important projects. And so if you have a project that has this much budget assigned to it or has this sort of external visibility, you need certain kinds of security resources to be a part of your team. And that makes these trained individuals very, very sought after and gives them a really powerful career path within the company. And I think it's done a lot in terms of attracting and retaining talent at Adobe. Changing the computer science curriculum is a big lift, and it's going to take at least a decade or more. We can engage with academia much more tactically and much sooner. I would encourage all of you to pick a college or university, Maybe it's one that you graduated from or some of your colleagues or alumnus from. Maybe it's one that you've hired successfully from in the past. Maybe it's a school that you've done some joint research with. Whatever it may be, pick a school that's nearby or convenient or has been useful in the past. Pick a professor, pick a project, and spend time with them. Share some resources, share information about what you're seeing in the real world, quote unquote, and learn from their research and their efforts. This can be a great recruiting pipeline, right? You find a professor who you build a relationship with, and then he sends or she sends her best students to you. But it can also be a great way to raise the bar overall in the academic setting. Because one thing that I've learned in my years of engaging with universities is what they're lacking is that real-world visibility. What are companies actually seeing? How are they being attacked today? What are the realistic responses they can put in place? And a little bit of knowledge from the industry can go a long way there. One of the big opportunities we have is to reach out to communities that are either particularly well-suited to filling security roles or and communities that are underrepresented in the security field today. I'd like to highlight three programs that I think do a good job of this. I think there are others and there can be more, so don't limit your survey to these. The first is the Scholarship for Women Studying Information Security, or SWSIS. This is a scholarship that's been run by AXA for several years and received a large grant from HP last year to expand it up to a number of additional students. It funds young women in either the last 2 years of an undergraduate program or the first 2 years of a master's program who are studying information security. Year Up is a program for urban youth. Helps place them in high-tech internships, high school-age kids. There's not a particular focus on security today in this program, but there could be. And I think it's a fantastic opportunity to start to introduce security as an important topic related to technology, but also to privacy, more broadly speaking, at the high school level before kids are into university. And then finally, talking about communities that are well-suited to fill security roles, the Cyber Combat Academy from the Wounded Warrior Project is a fantastic effort at taking service members who have received IT skills and training in the military and helping them segue into, in this case, security jobs in the industry. And we've seen this prove really, really effective because we've got a lot of folks coming out of the armed services today with fantastic high-tech skills and with the right mindset and the right mentality to work in the security profession. These last two aren't so much about bringing more talent into security as they are about diminishing the industry's need for talent. The reality is we're never going to have enough security professionals. We're never going to have enough expertise. And even if we did manage to mint enough new computer security experts, they will always be expensive because they will always be specialists. And so by collaborating with other organizations, by sharing what we see in terms of attacks that are coming in, and this is in the form of sharing threat intelligence, there are communities developing today that allow companies to share this information in automated ways. Some of them involve standards like Stix and Taxi. By collaborating, by sharing this information, we can present a unified front against the attackers, and we can avoid reinventing the wheel each time we analyze a new threat and develop a response to it. So the more we can share information with each other operationally, the less talent we will need internally, the lower the bar will be in terms of securing ourselves, because we'll be sharing and benefiting from the community. The other area that I think collaboration can be a big boon in is less tactical and more strategic. For the last 10 to 15 years, a lot of energy has gone into how to structure a software security initiative. How do you build security into an IT organization? And a project that I'm a co-author of called the Building Security and Maturity Model provides some of this. It's a model for assessing the maturity of a software security initiative. But it's also that a community of those member firms that have measured themselves that get together and share information under Chatham House rules in an annual conference. And that kind of open open sharing of information about lessons they've learned, about how they've structured their programs, about what the new challenges they're seeing, can really help the rest of that community get ahead of some of the problems. So again, I think we can collaborate very effectively both tactically and strategically to reduce the need for security talent overall. The last point I want to talk about is technology. And technology is another example of something that can help us reduce our need for humans to solve these security problems. But it can be a double-edged sword. And to help explain that, I'd like to use the chainsaw as an example. No one buys a chainsaw and takes it out in the backyard, drops it off, goes to sleep, and expects to come out the next morning and find all the trees cut down. However, if you were a lumberjack today and you showed up to work with an axe instead of a chainsaw, you'd be laughed out of the forest. You wouldn't be a very effective lumberjack. And so the point is, just because I buy a chainsaw doesn't mean that it is either going to cut down all the trees for me or instantly make me into a lumberjack. But if I know what I'm doing and I employ the tool correctly, it can absolutely accelerate and amplify my contributions. Security tools are exactly the same way. Rarely does a security tool replace a person. But if they're used effectively, technology is used effectively, it can absolutely amplify the capabilities of a person, make those capabilities more predictable. So the caveat I have here is that many security tools scale linearly with people. And so yes, they amplify what a person does, but they also require more people to do more work. And so if you bring technology to bear on a problem that you're already solving, it can greatly reduce the amount of talent you need. If you bring technology to bear to solve a new problem, it can actually drive the demand for more talent. It can actually require more personnel to operate it. And so think carefully and use technology intelligently to try to address this. So I've talked about seven different examples. They ranged from, as I said, probably a decade or more effort to change what it means to teach computer science, all the way down to much more tactical things like adopting a professor or starting a security internship program. What I've done on this slide is I've broken down the different steps into four buckets: internal activities, external activities, philanthropic activities, and activities revolving around the academic community. And what I would suggest is that everybody pick preferably one from each bucket, but maybe just a couple of buckets, and get started with something today. Some of these things, taken to their eventuality, can be very big, require a lot of resources, take a lot of time, and the benefits won't necessarily be felt directly back to your company. It's more about fixing the industry as a whole. But others are very tactical. Others will help you fill recs that are open this quarter that you need to fill. And so what I leave you with is, again, this is one of the biggest problems we face today. We won't be able to continue to depend on IT the way we have thus far unless we solve this problem. And unless every organization begins to contribute and begins now, we're just falling further and further behind. Thank you very much.